But today I want to start with Psalm 103. Psalm 103. The Lord's Word. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget none of his benefits. Who pardons all your iniquities? Who heals all your diseases? Who redeems your life from the pit? Who crowns you with loving kindness and compassion? Who satisfies your years with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagle? The Lord performs righteous deeds and judgments for all who are oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the sons of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in loving kindness. He will not always strive with us, nor will he keep his anger forever. The Lord's word. Pray with me. Father God, we do thank you that you are a God of grace. You are a God of compassion. You are a God of loving kindness. You are a God of peace. We celebrate joyously these elements of your person, the qualities of your character that come down to us through the reading of your word, and also as we experience you in our lives day by day. We have felt your grace. We have felt your loving kindness. We have enjoyed when you have healed us from diseases. We know you are there with us in difficult times. You comfort us when situations arise that require us and draw us into prayer with you. We lift up those among us, those of our friends and family who have medical needs, who have surgeries coming up this week, who are recovering from COVID and just out of the hospital. We ask for your patience and your presence with us as we deal with some difficult circumstances, as we age, and as we deal with the aspects of life that are difficult in raising our children and grandchildren. We thank you for all of these gifts of grace to us that you provide each other for us to support as we walk in this earth. You brought us into fellowship with you, and you brought us into fellowship with others here in this place. We love you, Lord, and we thank you for all of these elements of grace. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. How many of you look back to the time before you knew the Lord and can echo some of those words of the song? Until grace found you. If I were to interview you and say, what was your life like before you came to know the Lord? Before you felt his influence in your life? How many of you were less than age 10 when that happened? Two? Three? Jim's not sure. Less than age 20. Okay. A few more. How about over age 20? Yeah, a lot of us over age 20. I was 26 when I figured out what grace was all about. And when I think back to what was going on in my life in the mid-20s, you know, I can't help but have a tear come to my eye. You know, putting myself back in the 26-year-old's memories of what was happening. And then what happened when my life was transformed in a couple of years after that. Grace found me. I didn't find grace. Grace found me. He came looking for me. Amen? He came looking for all of us. Oh, going to be a tearjerker kind of a message if I keep going this way, so I'll stop. But I never really understood what it was like to be in church my whole life, to be in the faith, to study from age, you know, two, three, four, five, six. Never set foot in a church. Wasn't on my parents' docket to even think that I needed any spiritual education whatsoever. My first time I stepped in a religious establishment was a Salvation Army. And I only did it because it was Wednesday night dinners, right? And that's what took me into a Salvation Army. And I remember that as a younger kid, you know, 12 years old, 11, 12 years old at the time, singing all these songs, I had no idea what they were about, but that's what we did, you know. And then it wasn't until my mid-20s that I ever stepped back into a church, and I got in because I was playing basketball, and the church was opening up the doors to play basketball on a Tuesday night, and then I came into the church. And through those experiences, he brought me into the fellowship because grace was explained to me. We have two passages of scripture to read today. The first one is in 2 Corinthians 9:8. 2 Corinthians 9:8. Paul's words to this Corinthian church. God is able to make all grace abound to you, that having all sufficiency in everything, you may have an abundance for every good work. I like that. Well, with the church's indulgence, I'm going to read it again. He says, Paul says to the Corinthians, God is able to make all grace abound to you, that always having all sufficiency in everything, you may have an abundance for every good deed. If you look at that verse, you have all, everything, every, abundance. The words are just repeated to being global, that you have everything that you could possibly need if you have grace in your life. But what is grace? You know, what do we think grace is, grace means? If I were to ask you what the definition of grace is, what would you say it is? It's a term that is all over the Bible, all over the New Testament, right? It's the beginning of prayers. Paul opens up his passages, his epistles, with grace and peace to you. So it's in the introduction. It's in the middle. It's in the ending prayers where Paul will pray and say, I pray, may the peace and grace of God be with you always, you know? So it's repeated a lot. But what is grace? What would be your definition of grace? As I shared on Wednesday night, there's an acronym for grace that people have used, God's riches at Christ's expense. They use that for grace. So, but I looked up grace in the dictionary. Grace is used in so many different ways. There's so many different definitions. There were like 15 of them. I couldn't list them all. The first one said courteous goodwill. Courteous goodwill. Your grace is used like in an introduction to some people in royalty, you know. So if you're going to address the queen or the king, you would say your grace or your lord or something like that in that case. So I had to fast forward through all of these other grace, and I said, let me figure out what Christian grace is. What's the definition of Christian grace? I found a couple. This says, the help given to one by God because God desires one to have it, not necessarily because of anything one has done to earn it. I like that definition. I like that a lot. So if you can imagine, I brought somebody up here on stage and I handed them a gift. Let's say it was a gift of chocolates. If I brought Alita up here and I said, here's a gift of chocolates, she'd look at me and say, great, thanks, I can't eat it. Most likely, right? But if I bought Eleonora up, or I bought Sarah up, or I brought Hope up and I said, here, you come to church, here's a gift of chocolates, and we had a conversation. And that conversation, you know, what would somebody say? Somebody say, well, thank you, Pastor. You know, what did I do to deserve this? Well, nothing. It's just, I'm just going to give you some chocolate. Is it because I came to church? No, it's just because I care for you as a pastor, and here you go. You know, grace. It's just a gift. It's just a gift given without merit, without working, without, you know, deserving it. So my definition of grace is the free and unmerited favor of God. Free, unmerited favor of God. That's grace. That's my definition of grace. It shows up in a lot of things. It shows up in salvation, because salvation is free. Salvation is unmerited. You don't do anything to earn it. You can't do anything to earn it. You can't buy it. You can't pay for it. You know, it's free. It's unmerited. And it's given by God. God owns grace. God is a God of grace. So when I ask people about grace, I get a couple of different questions. I get one that says, is grace unlimited? Is there unlimited grace? Does grace ever run out? Could I ever get to a point where I have no longer have any grace? And I said, well, with people, sure. You can try people's patience. They give you a latitude. They give you grace for a little bit. And then you continually come at them and come at them and come at them. And then tap is off. I've had enough. Grace is run out. All right? You guys have had experiences with that in your life. But with God, is God's grace unlimited? The Bible says yes. Unlimited grace. Which brings about the next question, which usually comes from somebody. Can you abuse God's grace? Can you abuse it? Can you expect him to be graceful and continue to live your life against what he says in his word? Can you abuse his grace? What do you say?
Yes.
Yeah, you can. Which leads you to believe that grace can run out and not be unlimited. Can both of these be true? Because they seem to be on opposite sides of the same spectrum. It's interesting. We'll talk about that in a little bit, you know, here. Is his grace unlimited? To believers, yes. If you believe in him, if you have the Holy Spirit in your life, grace is unlimited. If the Holy Spirit is not in your life and you are not a believer, grace is limited. It will eventually run out. Your time will be up. That is what the Bible teaches. But some passages of Scripture. God is a God of grace, if you're filling in the sermon notes. God is a God of grace. Psalm 103 that I read earlier says this, "The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in love." We have a gracious God. Isaiah 30, 18, "Yet the Lord longs to be gracious to you. He will rise up and show you compassion. For the Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are those who wait for him." Not only is he gracious, but he longs to be gracious. He longs to find ways to be gracious. When Moses got the Ten Commandments in Exodus 34, this is what he records, "Then the Lord passed in front of him and proclaimed, 'The Lord God, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in loving kindness and truth, who keeps loving kindness for thousands, who forgives iniquity, transgressions, and sin.'" Even when delivering the Ten Commandments, which would set Israel on its course for a lot of different religious systems, he says, "I'm giving you these things because I abound in loving kindness. I'm compassionate and gracious." How many of you guys, in looking back at the Ten Commandments, saw compassion and graciousness by reading those? Israel certainly didn't think about them as compassionate and gracious. They bristled against them. The Pharisees created 611 rules based on the Ten Commandments, and that made the whole society bristle under that crush of religion, of Judaism, from that. But God's intent in delivering the commandments was to be gracious. Here's the way you should live. And if you look at the commandments purely, you will see that to be the case. The first four commandments vertical commandments, how you relate to God. And the last six, how we relate to each other. Hey, this is pretty gracious. Live this way. Don't kill your neighbor, right? Don't commit adultery. Don't steal from your neighbor. Don't covet something that your neighbor has. All of these things are be gracious to one another. And then the elements in the first four, be gracious to God. Have no other gods before him. He is your God. Be gracious to him. So be gracious vertically, be gracious horizontally. He intended those to be gracious things. And we didn't treat them that way. Israel didn't treat them that way. In Nehemiah 9, this is a time when they come back into the land. They have exported themselves from Babylon. They're back in the land. They're rebuilding the walls. Nehemiah chapter 9 is a great chapter where Israel confesses all of the sins of the past in there. And this is what it says. But in your great mercy, you did not put an end to them or abandon them. God didn't abandon Israel. For you are a gracious and merciful God. Even after all of the abuse of God throughout the Old Testament, the wanderings in the wilderness, getting carried away as the northern kingdom did into Assyrian rule, being carried away into Babylon. If you read what was going on at the time, you know, Ezekiel covers this in great detail. I think it's chapter 12, where he takes a magic carpet ride. God takes him on a magic carpet ride through the city of Jerusalem, and he observes all of the worship practices that are going on, all the worship of idols and statues and cattle and all of this stuff. And he says, I just want to tell you, show you, Ezekiel, what's going on with this. And through all of that, yet when they brought them back into the land, he is gracious and merciful. He didn't kill everybody, even though they deserved it. In Joel 2, the prophet writes, rend your heart and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God. He is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love. Can anybody relate to being away from the Lord for a period of time in your life and then coming back? If I brought somebody up to testify, yeah, there was a moment in my life in my 20s where I just went zoom this way for a while. And yet when the Lord brought me back, you know, he was compassionate and gracious, and I found love and forgiveness, you know, through him. A lot of stories like that within us. God is a God of grace. He is compassionate grace. And we have access to this grace. We are provided access to the throne of grace. That's what the writer of Hebrews said. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence. With confidence. So that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Does it boggle your mind that you can walk into the throne of glory and speak to God directly? The creator of the universe? That he says you have free access to walk in? How about if I just went up to 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue and said to the guy out front, hey, I'm going to go talk to the president or something like that. I got free access, right? I can walk right in the door. Or the owner of your company, you know? I can walk right in. I've got free access to that. And they're like, oh, it's Geoffrey. Hey, come on right in. Yeah, President Biden has been waiting to talk to you. Yeah, right. Who is this guy? Where are you from? Nebraska. I don't let people from Nebraska in here. You know, no access. But yet God allows us access into his very throne room to be able to speak to him. And we have the ability to do that. What a tremendous joy that is. Jesus came to deliver grace. You guys believe that? Jesus came to deliver grace. In Romans 3, Paul writes this in verse 23, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That's true. All are justified freely by his grace through redemption that came by Christ Jesus. It's like the Old Testament, they didn't understand God's grace. They needed a living example to understand what it was. And so God says, okay, I'm going to show up. I'm going to show them what it means. I'm going to be the element of grace in the person of the Son. I'm going to show them what grace is really all about. Some had this vision of the Old Testament God as a God of wrath, a God of thunder, a God of violence, a God that would punish any sin, you know, to the point of death immediately. They didn't have this vision of God being lowly, meek, lover of souls, caring, healing. And people ask the question, this guy Jesus, obviously he can't be God because my view of God is a God of wrath, and this guy doesn't look like a God of wrath. This guy looks like the softer side of Sears, if you remember those commercials back in the 70s, right? This guy's not the God that I have in mind. And yet he was fully God and fully man. And yet that is the vision of God, compassionate. He didn't kill everybody when they broke the commandments. He had patience. John describes this in John chapter 1. He says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory, glory as the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. Jesus was full of grace and truth. John testified about him and cried out, saying, this is he whom I said, he who comes after me has a higher rank than I, for he existed before me. He was God in the flesh. For of his fullness we have all received, and grace upon grace. Grace to the nth degree. Grace squared. We get grace and grace and grace from him. For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth were realized through Jesus Christ. Some versions of the Bible say revealed through Jesus. Jesus revealed the grace of the Father for us up close and personal. Do you think the people of his time need an example? Did they need an example of what grace was? To touch, to feel, to hear, to see? It's like we forget the things that God does for us in the past. We get so involved in our life, we forget what he has brought us through, how his grace showed up. God is forever reminding the children of Israel in the Old Testament what he's done for them. He told them to build statues and Ebenezers and remember all of the things. I'm the God who carried you out of Egypt. I'm the God who brought you through the waters. I'm the God who brought you into the promised land. We all forget what God has done for us. We shouldn't do that, should we? We should be remembering what God does for us. We should be telling people about what God does for us. I had a chance to meet with Herb Bessler and Bobby yesterday for about an hour, Bobby Julie's daughter, and they were struggling with the loss of Julie. Julie hadn't met her, but she obviously was a wonderful lady, made an impact on a lot of people's lives. You guys know, you know her. You know, I'm only hearing stories of her, trying to put together what this lady was like. And I sat over in Herb's house, and we were talking, and I said, how are you guys doing? Just pastoral heart. How are you guys doing? You know, Bobby breaks into tears, still struggling with this. It's been a short period of time. Herb, I'm guessing, doesn't say a whole lot normally. You guys know, but I could tell he was dealing with, you know, this. How do we deal with these kind of losses? And I got a few questions for the pastor, you know, from them. How do you deal with this situation in your life? What does a pastor say to that? Pastor says, 5 years ago, my mom passed away. I dealt with it. I got asked the question, how long should I expect sadness to stay with me? You know, that's a process. Everybody's different. There's still moments, I told them, where I have a situation happen in my life where I say, I got to call my mom. Oop, I need the heavenly directory in order to get there because she's up in glory. Hey, Lord, pass this message along, you know, to my mom. We live through these experiences. We help others through these experiences. We talk about Jesus. We remember the times that he brought us through difficult moments in our life, and we use those in order to communicate and help somebody else who's going through those situations. That's grace put on display for them. But we should always remember how he brought us through. We should talk about how he brought us through. The Bible also says we are saved by grace. Grace is the means by which we are saved. In Ephesians 1, it says this: he predestined us to adoptions as son through Jesus Christ to himself, according to the kind intention of his will, to the praise of his glory and his grace, which he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. That beautiful term, the beloved. Not just loved, but beloved. Overflowing, abundant love if you are in Christ and Christ is your Savior. Redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses and sins according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us. Salvation came through grace. Paul tells the Ephesians later, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And that's not of yourself. It's a gift of God. Just like the example of me giving chocolates to somebody where I pick at random out of the congregation to come up and grab it. It's free gift of God. Salvation is. Nothing you could do to earn it. In Titus 3, he saved us not on the basis of deeds which we have done in righteousness. We didn't work for it, but according to his mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewing by the Holy Spirit, which he poured upon us richly through Christ Jesus, our Savior. The Holy Spirit is a gift of grace in our lives, so that being justified by his grace, we would be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. We have this grace because he looked down history and decided that a guy named Plummer at age 26 was going to get this element of grace. It was just going to show up in his life. And the dude is going to figure it out. Some of us don't figure it out right away. Sometimes it takes a while for us to figure it out, right? But when we do, and when we understand the richness of this, that we were called in love, and grace was the way it happened, we have joy in that. Paul to the Galatians said, I do not set aside the grace of God, for it is righteousness could be gained through the law. Christ died for nothing. He says, I'm going to focus in on grace, because if I had to work for it, it doesn't mean anything. Christ didn't have to die. We don't have to celebrate communion if we could earn it. Why do they need to come to church? Why do they need to have a preacher? Why do they need to know about Jesus if you could earn your way to heaven? Anybody ever talk to you and you had the feeling that they thought they were earning their way to heaven? Happen a lot, right? How do you know that you're going to get to heaven? Well, I'm a good person. Yeah? Well, what does that mean? Good people go to heaven? Yeah. I mean, God's going to look at all this stuff that I've done and he's going to say, you know what? I'm a good person. I'm going to let you in. Really? Where in the Bible does it say that? Just curious. I mean, this is his communication to us. You figured he probably covered it somewhere. Maybe it's in an appendix. I haven't read that. It's a little different, you know, to me. It's by grace. Paul to the Romans said this, and if by grace, it cannot be based on works. If it were, grace would be no longer grace. What does that mean? If you had to work for it, a gift would no longer be a gift, right? How many of you on your birthday received a nice gift recently? If I brought Jerry up here and say, hey, Jerry, on your birthday, what did you get for, you know, your birthday? Did you get a nice gift? Oh, yeah, I got a project. Go renovate the basement. It's a gift, you know. But if you got a nice gift, maybe it was a dinner made for you. Maybe it was a new shirt or a power tool or something like that, you know. And then Cheryl looked at you and say, okay, now because you had to earn your gift, I need you to do X, Y, Z, Q, P. You need to do all of this stuff. And he's going to look at that list and he's going to go, you can have your gift back.
I don't want to do that. If I got to do a laundry list here of things here in order to get my birthday gift, that's not a gift. I'm working for it, right? This is like a job. Don't you know I retired? You know, I'm not going to talk about honey-do lists or anything like that at that point in time. But, I mean, that's the point of Paul. If you got to work for it, it's not a gift. It's not a gift at all. In Acts 15, it says this, "We believe that through the grace of our Lord Jesus, we are saved just as the Gentiles are." This coming knowledge of Peter, that the Gentiles are recipients of the gift as same as the Jews are benefits of this grace gift of salvation. Peter figures it out. Oh, I get it. I'm saved by grace. I'm not saved by following all these 611 laws that the Pharisees put out. I'm saved by grace. Later on in Romans, it says this, "But the gift is not like the trespass. For if many died by the trespass of one man, that being Adam, how much more did God's grace overflow in the gift that came by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ?" The overflowing gift of salvation. It is a gift. It is a gift. What are the additional benefits of grace? Not only salvation. Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy 1, 9 this, "He saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything that we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace." The fact that you live a life set apart from others is a gift. How many of you have walked through a situation in life which was a difficult situation and you come out the other side of it and you say, "Wow, I handled that pretty well." You know? Anybody have a situation like that where you're surprised at your own behavior? Like, "Man, I could have really gotten angry with that guy for what he said, but you know what? I didn't. I came out of that okay." That's part of God's grace gift. He's changing us to be more graceful himself. In Ephesians 4, it says, "But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it." Like my example earlier where I said I was going to bring somebody up and hand them some chocolate. To somebody else, I might hand them a gift card to Walmart. To somebody else, I might hand them, "You're going to get, you know, an hour with the pastor every week to talk about whatever you want to talk about." To somebody, I'm given a gift of teaching ability. To somebody else, God has apportioned a grace gift of being a minister and standing here and speaking. To others, he's given this gift of compassion, where you can be next to somebody who's going through such a deep trial in their life, and you're there and you're comforting them. That's a gift of grace, to have patience with people. I think God gives a gift of patience to all mothers. I know that he had given a gift to my mother, patience. Sarah, can I get an amen from the back of the place here, right? Yeah, I mean, he gives this grace to mothers to be able to deal with children. And some of the things that I can remember back from the days of talking to my mom, the girl had a lot of grace to be able to deal with me when I was that age. He gives us different things. The passage I read earlier in 2 Corinthians 9, "God is able to make all a grace abound to you, having all sufficiency in everything, you may have an abundance for every good deed." In that scene, he's talking about finances, right? He's talking about wealth. He's talking about possessions. And he says, in essence, you can't outgive God. He says, "I want you to give." He's taking up a collection for the saints in Jerusalem who need it. And he's coming there and he says, you know, whatever you give in order to support the Lord's mission, God is going to overflow and give back to you. And that you'll have a sufficiency in all things, self-sufficient in the Holy Spirit. You will be in need of nothing. How many of you in your life have given financially to some cause and then wondered when you were doing it, "I don't know, am I going to be able to recover? Am I going to be able to meet my bills?" Anybody really stepped out in faith and given like that, not knowing if you were going to be able to handle the next bill that comes in or the next time of economic circumstances in your life? I can remember moments in my life where the Lord called me to give, and after I'm writing a check or turning in, you know, a donation or something like that, I'm like, oh, well, I should probably think of if I'm going to be able to make the mortgage, you know? But you live in the gift of the moment. And Paul says he is going to fill your coffers so that you have an abundance, an overflowing abundance. That word picture is like you just took water in a cup and you continue to pour and pour and pour until the water overflows the rim of the cup. Anybody want to give testimony they've experienced that in their life where God continues to provide and it just seems to come because he loves us and it just comes out of nowhere, you know? I've talked to people in counseling because I do finance, as you guys know. Tax time is very interesting. I get conversations with people about their finances, and I've told people, man, money just seems to follow you around. No matter what happens in your life, money just seems to follow you around. And I've got a lady who right now I'm working with, that's true. No matter what she does, money follows her around. She does well in everything. And then I look at contributions. What are you giving back? What are you doing with this grace that you've been given? Are you contributing, you know, back for all these things that you have had happen in your life, all these blessings that you had get? It's something that we consider. Paul said, this is part of grace. You get a lot, you can give a lot, you get a lot more. That's what he's trying to say in this abundance of it. In Romans 5:21, he says, just as sin reigned in death, so also grace might reign through righteousness to bring eternal life. Eternal life is a gift of God's grace. Grace produces a lifestyle that is eternal life. And as we've said before from the pulpit here, eternal life starts here on earth. As soon as the Holy Spirit comes to live inside of you, you have eternal life at that point, and that is a gift. It means that your mindset changes to a biblical view, not an earthly view. That happens over time. How many of you think you have a biblical worldview of what's going on in the world right now? When you have things you see on TV, you know, where it's just crazy stuff is going on, school shootings and dumb stuff and people acting totally out of line. Do you have a biblical worldview with that? Do you realize where that fits in to society and what the Bible says about the future? That was the question I got last week, you know, for the Ask the Pastor questions, the blog I wrote. It was, how do you understand what we're seeing in society? What's our biblical worldview? And I wrote that, you know, Saturday before last and dwelled on all of those things. And this is where we are as a society. We need to have a biblical worldview, not an earthly worldview. The writer of Hebrews says, don't be carried away with all these kinds of strained teaching. It's good for our hearts to be strengthened by grace. Grace produces strength. Paul told Timothy, you then, my son, be strong in the grace that is Christ Jesus. Grace produces strength. You don't have fear when grace fills your life. Doubts fade away when grace fills your life. You have this strength inside, this internal strength that grows. In 2 Peter 1, Peter says, grace and peace be yours in abundance through the knowledge of God. So peace is the result of having grace in your life. Strength. Peace. Paul to the Romans said, for sin shall no longer be your master. No longer be your master. You're not under the law. You're under grace. The Ten Commandments didn't apply to the people anymore because there were grace. Is that true? That's what people taught. Forget the Old Testament. New Testament is all that matters. No. The law was here. Grace is here. You're not only no longer under the law, you're under grace. This is a mindset that he's calling them to. The mindset is, don't just look at the law. Look at living in grace. Look up higher than that. right? The law was given to show that you were going to fall, that you can't make it. Grace was given to you to experience this abundant life that Jesus talks about in John 10. Abundant life in grace. In Ephesians 3, Paul says this: the Gentiles are fellow heirs and fellow members of the body and fellow partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel, of which I was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace. Paul thought it was a grace gift that he became a minister to the Gentiles. My guess is on the Damascus Road in Acts 9, he didn't immediately think that when he was blinded and he was told he was persecuting God himself. God showed up and said, "You're on the wrong path, man." But later on in his life, in reflection, he saw that as a gift of grace. And he said this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unfathomable riches of Christ. Being a minister is a gift of grace. Peter says, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus is revealed. Grace should be something that we hope to see up close and personal when the Lord shows up. Revelation 19, if you want to go see where that's at. But then there's this section about living under grace. How should we live with grace in our life? Do you remember in 2 Corinthians, Paul had this thing in his eye? He called it a thorn in the flesh. He wanted it to go away. You remember what God told him? My grace is sufficient for you. Grace allows us to live with some difficult circumstances in life. How many of you are feeling the effects of age when you wake up and walk daily, by day, by day? I'm feeling them, you know. We're all feeling them, and yet we're still alive. We're still breathing. We're still in joy, you know. We still worship. We still sing. We still praise. We still come to church because His grace is a higher level to that. I don't know about you guys, but I wake up every morning. If I get a good 6 hours of sleep, I immediately go into prayer. You know what? Thank you, Lord, for a good night's sleep. Just that, right? As a healthcare professional, Sarah, you probably say everybody needs a good night's sleep, right? I mean, it's just this joy for me to be able to get that, because at my age and infirmities in my back, that's tough to get sometimes. You know, pain sometimes wakes you up. But that's an element of grace as well. The question that Paul asked the Romans in Romans 6, 1 and 2, what shall we say then? Are we going to continue to sin that grace will increase all the more? Does grace mean that I can live any way that I want because the grace is gonna continue to come? If I gave Eleonora a bunch of chocolates up here and she immediately ripped through all of them, right away, thinking that he's just going to give me more at the end of the worship service, you know, that's a little presumptuous, right? But some of us know people who live that way. They live all out on the week, you know, during the week, and they come in on Sunday and they hope for, okay, check the box, cleanse this, you know, start over. And then they go back out and they live the way they want to live. And they don't have any aspect of grace in their life for 6 days and 23 hours, you know, expecting the 1 hour is going to make a difference with that. No, grace doesn't mean we willingly go on sinning. In Matthew 18, this passage, Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to 7 times? And Jesus answered, I tell you, not 7 times, but 70 times 7. If we are people of grace, we should give grace to others. How many of you think you're graceful? What comes to mind when I ask, are you graceful? Yeah, something to do with our physical performance, you know. My daughter was a little bit of a tomboy, my middle daughter. She was just a little bit of a rough and tumble kind of girl, you know. When she was age 7, I said, I need to get this girl into dance lessons because she needs some grace. She's going to kill somebody, you know. our definition of grace is more towards that in our mind. Are you graceful? That is, do you freely display and deliver grace to others? That shows up in patience. That shows up in caring. That shows up in listening, really a lot more, you know? Do we actually listen to our friends and neighbors and family who need a good biblical opinion for things? That's the definition of grace that we want to see here. In Titus 2, it says, "For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age." The fact that we are recipients of grace means that we should live at a higher level. We should live holy, set-apart lives. We should be self-controlled. We shouldn't have arguments. Rage shouldn't fill our life, you know, completely. That shouldn't be how we are known. We should live godly lives. James spent a lot of time with this in James 4. Maybe you guys can relate to this. What is the source of your quarrels and conflicts among you? Anybody ever been a part of a quarrel and a conflict in a church? That's the mic drop moment. Is not the source of your conflict your pleasures that wage war in your members? You lust, you do not have, so you commit murder. You are envious and cannot obtain, so you fight and quarrel. You don't have because you don't ask. You don't ask, you do not receive. You ask with wrong motives, that you may spend it on your pleasures. You fight for control. You have to be the top dog. It has to be your way. You always have to be right. You always have to be the last word on any situation. Anybody relate to this? James writes, "Do you think the scripture speaks no purpose?" He says, "What I get out of scripture is this. He gives greater grace. Therefore, God says, God is opposed to the proud, but give grace to" who? The humble. Humility. I think the answer to all church conflict is humility. All conflict, humility. You know, if we're supposed to live under grace, we should be humble to that. And then there's some people who need this teaching of humility. And you can put yourself back into situations where discussions and arguments and debates have happened, and you say, you know, was this person really humble? Was I humble? Were we both focusing on grace, or were we focusing on control? It's an element of testimony. Peter says the same thing. He says, "Clothe yourself with humility towards one another. God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble." I remember talking to a guy on the street, and he was looking for some food. It was in Atlanta. My daughter was with me. We were walking down there, and he's like, "Man, can I have some money?" And I'm like, "What do you want money for?" He says, "I'm hungry. I need some food." And I said, "Let's go get you some food." With my daughter in tow, we went to a Waffle House, if you know what those places are, you know, and I got him some food, and, you know, he apparently had some, let's say, discussions with the people in the Waffle House in the past, and he says, "I can't go in there." I'm like, "Why can't you go in there? We're gonna get some food for you." "No, no, they won't let me in there." "Okay, why not?" "You don't want to know." I'm like, "Well, let's find out." So I walk in with him, and I say, "Come on, we're going to get you some food." And as soon as he walks in the door from behind the counter, "I told you, buddy, you're not supposed to be in there." And then he starts yelling from the front, "You guys are all evil and mean, and you don't care for me." And this is this debate going on, and I'm like right in the middle of this. And I'm like, dude, calm down. The lady at the counter, "We're just going to get him some food. Is that okay?" It's like, "Okay, yeah, but he has to leave as soon as he gets out of there." I'm like, obviously the two sides of that discussion weren't going really well. I walked into a quagmire of history of debates, discussions, arguments, and stuff like that. After we get him his food, and I said, we need to pray for this food. And he just, you know, I thank you so much, you know, young man, because he was older than I was. Thank you that you provided this for me. And I'm like, dude, you got the wrong guy. I'm just a beggar showing another beggar where the food is, right? He gives this to me. He's given this to you. Reorient yourself to the fact that Jesus and his grace is the only thing that's providing you this food, is what I was telling him. And after he was finished with the meal, we were about ready to leave. I said, now you got to do something. And he's like, what? I said, you need to go over to that lady and you need to apologize for your actions. You need to ask for her forgiveness. And you need to say, I'm not going to do whatever it was that you did in the past that caused this argument and discussion. I don't want to do that. They didn't ask you if you wanted to do that. I said, you're going to do that because you're supposed to live at peace with everybody. It's what Paul said in Romans 12. If at all possible, live at peace with all men. I said, you don't want to live in the same argument the next time you come in here? He's like, you make a lot of sense, young man. I'm like, well, that's good because I didn't get this. It came from the Bible. You know, you should live this way. Living in grace, being humble in your circumstances, not being angry, not having debate like that the whole time. It's a more peaceful way of life. And sometimes it takes us a moment when we're in a difficult situation, when a heated argument is going to happen, when you know it's going to happen, you walk into a situation to put the pause button on and say, you know what? I don't want to go there. I'm going to live in the fact that I'm in grace at this moment, and I'm going to give grace to somebody else, you know, at that moment in time. And it kind of quells conflict for that. Peter tells us, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. To him be glory forever. Amen. Grow in grace. What that tells us is that we're not going to be superstars in grace straight out of the gate, that he's still working on us. He's still providing situations where we need grace in our life. We're not expected to know everything. We're not expected to live perfectly. We should cheer at that, right? But what we should be is growing in grace over time. We should be able to look back on our lives and say, you know what, last year I would have reacted this way to this situation. This year, I'm a little more muted. I remember I wrote about this in my book. This lady kept walking the aisle, you know, at the church. Anytime somebody had an altar call, she kept walking the aisle. And I'm like, girl, why do you keep walking my aisle? I was doing usher at the time, and I see her every Sunday walking the aisle, Baptist church, invitation, every Sunday. And I'm like, so the first time didn't work for you? And she looked at me, like, really serious look on her face. And she said, I just want him to know that I'm serious. You just want God to know that you're serious and you're walking the aisle each time? And I said, so, in your life, you know, you seem like a nice, calm person. Were you always that way? Oh, no. No, I was a really angry, you know, person. You know, I was from the country. I grew up with a girl on the country, you know, a little tomboyish kind of thing. I would fight and tussle with everybody. I was angry. I held grudges. And I said, so you don't do that anymore? No, I don't do that anymore. And she said, looked at me and she said, I guess I've mellowed with age. That was her line. I've mellowed with age. And I'm like, you ain't done no mellowing with age. The Holy Spirit is working on your life. He's changing you from the inside out. You don't do that anymore because he's changing you to be different. So stop walking my aisle. You're in, right? That change doesn't happen unless the Holy Spirit is in your life and grace is showing up, you know, in your life. Her frown and concern turned this big smile on her face. Thank you, young man, for explaining that, you know, to me. We tend to forget the way we lived in the past. We should see changes in our life, and the reflection of a godly life and grace in our living is an element of the fact that we're in the kingdom. He doesn't renovate non-believers. Amen? He renovates his kids, his chosen, his beloved. Lastly, there's prayers for grace. Paul, as I said before, ended a lot of his messages with prayer. He says in the 2 Corinthian letter near the end, "May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all." He calls the entire Trinity, and his prayer is that grace would fill these guys' life. If you remember the tone of 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians, it's not positive, right? In the first letter, he's telling them, you guys are screwing it all up. In the second letter, he's defending himself because they say, we're not listening to you. The two letters of Corinthians are not good. There were two other letters that he wrote to the Corinthians that were worse than that, that are not part of the canon of Scripture. It wasn't a positive relationship. But in the end of it, he's still praying that grace will show up in their life. Bible quiz time. Anybody know what the last verse of the Bible is? The last verse. Revelation 22:21. The last verse. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with God's people. Amen. That's John's last word. That's the Lord's last inspired word on print in the Bible is a prayer for the grace of the Lord Jesus to be with his own. It is grace. Grace applied. Grace understood. Grace lived out. It's grace that brings us to the table. The grace of remembering what Christ has done for us. The grace of recommitment as we live our life to the principles that he has in his word for us. It's a grace of understanding what his sacrifice meant for us and then agreeing to live in the way that he asks us to live. So as we think about coming to the table, taking the elements, prepare yourself. Are you living in his grace? Have you committed yourself to his grace? Does his grace affect you in your life? Are there things that you need to ask forgiveness for where maybe you didn't live up to that standard of grace, that very, very high standard of grace? The communion table is a time of quiet to let all of that out in conversation with him, to ask for forgiveness for those maybe transgressions you haven't asked for forgiveness for, and for recommitting yourself to be people of grace because he is a God of grace. God, we do thank you for being with us. We thank you for moments in our life that teach us. We thank you for the ability to remember where we were in the past, to remember where you brought us from, to remember the old us, the one that wasn't living according to your ways, that made many, many mistakes, that was constantly running afoul of a holy life, and to say thank you for bringing us to a point in our life where we can recognize the renovation that you're doing inside of us. When we come to the table, our hearts are open and filled with joy as we remember the sacrifice of you willingly going to the cross for our sins. We take these elements in our hand. We do so out of devotion and love for the one who said, "Greater love has no man than this, a man who would lay his life down for his friends." We thank you, Lord, for a study on grace. Call us to be people of grace in a community that may view this church as something not graceful. Let us renovate our perception in the community through extending love and care and grace to others. And thank you, Lord, for all that you do for us. all that you've taught us, all that you call us to be accountable for all the experiences of life, good, bad, or otherwise, where you help us to understand grace and apply grace. Thank you for never leaving us nor forsaking us, and for loving us with your very life. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Our communion table today, we have a song that Kat's going to play as the Deacon Don and Jerry, will you come and deliver the elements for it? And then we'll have a celebration song at the end. Kat, go ahead and play that, gentlemen.
His body, his blood.
The night the Lord was betrayed, he took the bread and broke it. And he said, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat." And then he took the cup and said, "This is my blood spilled for you. Take and drink." We thank you, Lord, for your sacrifice for us. We remember you with love. We remember you with devotion. We remember you with the commitment and dedication of our life to be with you in service to those around us. And we love you, Lord. Amen. Amen.
Hey, this is Dr. Geoffrey Plummer of Calvary Baptist Church in Cambridge. I want to thank you for listening to our sermon video today. I pray that your heart was blessed by listening to our message of the day, and I hope you'll stick around and look for more information on our website, which is cbccne.org. There you will find additional links to sermon video, as well as a blog that I write every week to our fellowship here at Calvary Baptist Church. Again, thank you for listening and watching our video today, and I pray that you have a blessed day.